totally that the connection between the dots and the past experience. How do the dots come?
You see, two things. That is the, I can say, that is the question. Still, not only nobody can answer, nobody has answered. Not only nobody has answered, nobody can answer. You are asking like a, how did I fall into the dream? If I ask, how did you fall into the dream yesterday night? Can you answer? You see, you can, you know the possibility that you came out of the dream. You are able to come out of the dream, na? Then there is a possibility. But you can't analyze or understand how did you get into the dream. See, same way, you can come out of this dream, but you can't analyze and find out how did I get into this dream, because the logic which you have now is not capable of understanding, it is not bright enough to understand how did you get into this situation.
With your past experience of what you are projecting for the future, will it not lead to thoughtlessness?
I can tell you one thing.
You mind will become silent, and it will lead to thoughtlessness, which is meditation according. For reaching that, unclutching the.
That is the part I was thinking.
Two things. First thing, the moment you think about the thoughtlessness or silence, you think that you will be in that same state and your body and your life will not run. Am I right? I want to tell you that it will lead to thoughtlessness. Then you start imagining that.
No, I think automatically it will
lead. Automatically it will lead. But I can say, it will lead to a silence. It will lead to a kind of a peace in the initial level. But I don't say that is ultimate. Then something breaks in you. Something happens in you, the regular thought or what you call as a thought or mind, everything is happening, your body moves, your day-to-day life happens, but you never come back as your old personality. Maybe I can use the word sahaja samadhi. You never come back as the old personality. You just live. See, I can use this word. The psychological revolution happens in you. The cognition, how you receive information, process it, and give the answers. That whole process becomes different. I don't want to say that you will become thoughtless completely. You understand? The moment I say the word, you will become thoughtless. You start thinking that I will become completely silent and I will not be able to do anything. My body will not move, my mind will not move. No. That does not happen.
Because we are unaware. That's why our thoughts keep on connecting it with the past experience or whatever it is. My question to you is how to become aware. You are saying that you disconnect your thought. But it automatically keeps on happening. That you keep on connecting.
What I am saying, when in the initial level, you may have to sit in the beginning for some time and continuously unclutch. Then it will bring you a kind of a silence. You will settle down. Then after that, continuously whole day, when you walk, sit or stand or do anything, even remembering that idea unclutching. You see, the idea unclutching, this is what I call initiation. That idea is like a stick used to burn the dead bodies. In India, if you see the burning of the dead bodies, after burning, they will throw that stick also into that fire. Same way, this idea of unclutching will burn all other clutches and difficulties. Finally, this idea also will be put in the same fire.
Swamiji, in the beginning you were saying, Yampa, it is actually a portable knowledge, and it may not lead to that, what you are saying, the disconnecting the thought. But now you are saying that maybe in the beginning you may have to stick and disconnect your thoughts.
See, in the beginning, I was not saying it is bad or anything. I was saying we have something more to offer.
But japa can be also one of the techniques to disconnect.
Yes, surely. Surely. It can also lead in the initial level. In the initial level, see, there are different layers in our being. Physical body which you are carrying. Yoga will help for the physical body. The second, the pranic layer, the prana happening inside you. Pranayama will help to work on that layer. The third, mental layer, inner chattering you are having. The japa, repetition of some word or idea, the mantra, can help you that layer. The fourth, emotions. Some visualization, can help that layer, that we call it as a subtle layer, sukshma sarira. Then the deeper layers are again like anandamaya kosha, or the deep sleep, karana sarira. Those layers can be helped by this method of unclutching. So different techniques or different layer helps. Different techniques can penetrate, can help you at a different level, different layer. What I am trying to say about this unclutching, when you try to experiment this unclutching, a very simple thing, all you need to do, remember that unclutching, instead of giving meaning, connecting with the old thoughts and allowing that, see, when you create a thought, you are a Brahma. When you maintain a thought, you are a Vishnu. When you destroy a thought, you are Shiva. If you don't do all these three, you are Parabrahma. Unclutching is a method, it's like a self-purifying. As long as you are in the mental layer, now we are talking in the mental layer. This will be like a technique, like a mental layer. The moment you become subtle, actually if you try it, when you experiment with this technique, suddenly you will see, you don't even have to repeat the word unclutching, that very idea repeats. It becomes subtle. See, any technique which can purify itself, the moment when you become subtle, the technique also should become subtle by itself. Then it's a liberating technique. The technique which does not become subtle by itself, which stays as a grass, at one point, if it is not able to dilute itself, if it is not able to disappear, if it is not able to kill itself, if the technique is not able to commit suicide, it will kill you. Yes. Maybe. But I can say, when you emphasize on the initial technique, in the initial thing, then that is where the problem starts. So let the emphasis be on this corner, this side of the shore. Let the technique commit suicide. When you grow, when you become more subtle, let the technique commit suicide and let you become more and more subtle. Let the emphasis be on this side. I can say the difference between the normal mind and living enlightenment. See, the normal mind, you know, it functions, it works, all of us know. And in between, there is a space called silence. When you become thoughtless and actionless, yogaha chitta vritti nirodaha, when there is no thought and no action, complete chitta vritti happens. The chitta vritti nirodha happens. Cessation of the mind, that happens. The next thing happens is, I can give you this example. As on now, if we have 10-acre land, the 10-acre land is our mind. Everything is continuously moving, jumping, restless. But when you live enlightenment, when you come to that ultimate truth, it's not that the activity in the 10-acre stops, suddenly you have a 10 million acre. In the 10 million acre, the activity in the 10-acre is negligible. First state is 10-acre land, and all 10-acre is restless. Second state, all the 10-acre is in silence. Third state, what I call Sahaj Samadhi, or living enlightenment, you have 10 million acre, the 10-acre restlessness is there, the activity is there, but you are never touched by it. You are never disturbed by it. The day-to-day life is happening. Every day life is running. Every day your life is moving. See, the creation, maintenance, and the decision making in your life is continuously happening, but the constant irritation which you carry now is missing. That will be missing. That's what I call living enlightenment. This unclutching, in the initial level, you may need to remember as word. Then slowly, it will become like a concept. Then it will not even be a concept, it will be just a remembrance. It will become juice of your very being. Every moment, whether you understand or not, want it or not, you are unclutching. Unless you unclutch from the earlier thought, can the next thought come in? No. See, for example, the moment you decide to stand up, you renounce the thought of sitting. The moment you decide to come in, you renounce the thought of standing outside. The moment you decided to walk out, you renounce the thought of sitting inside. Am I right? Only when the earlier thought is renounced, the next thought can come inside your inner space. People ask me, Swamiji, I am suffering with the fear of death. What should I do? I tell them, have a cup of coffee. Now, it may look very funny. How can I have a cup of coffee and come out of the death fear? Understand, the moment you are able to have a thought that let me have a cup of coffee, whatever fear it may be, it has to leave your inner space. Am I right? Unless that leaves your inner space, you cannot have the thought, let me have a cup of coffee. You may say, no, but the fear comes back. Then have one more cup of coffee, that's all. See, if you know once how to get the fear out, apply the same thing second time. You may ask, how many cup of coffee I can have? The next time I have a cup of water, that's all. See, looks very simple. And just because it looks very simple, we are not able to trust it. Let me go a little deeper into this truth. Let me dive a little deep into this truth. Continuously, whether you want or not, you can have only one thought. You can have continuously, no doubt, but only one thought at a time. Let me make these few statements. If I am wrong, please correct me. If I am right, please internalize it. First thing, you can have only one thought at a time. Second thing, unless the old thought is moved out, pushed out, the second thought cannot come. Third thing, if somebody can push me out and sit here, he is surely powerful than me. If somebody can push me from here and sit here, he is surely more powerful than me. Means any thought which is coming and pushing the old thought out is more powerful. Means, see, any thought which is coming now is rooted in the present moment. And naturally the old thought is dead. You may be having a worst fear of death or worst greed or lust, whatever it is. The moment new thought has come, it is dead. The old thought is dead. It has no power over your inner space. It has to leave you. See, a cup of coffee can replace your worst fear of death. It happens in you. When it happens in your inner space, just see and understand. You may say, no, it comes back. It cannot be that simple, Swami. No, we live, we know. It's not that you live, I also live. Please understand, I am responsible for what I am talking. I have seen what I am talking. That's the reason I am talking to you. When a thought can come inside and replace the earlier thought, it means naturally this thought is more powerful. The problem, the only difficulty we have is you start thinking, no, it may come back, it will come back. If it comes, you see, once you know how to replace it, why are you afraid of it coming back? Why should we constantly concentrate on it coming back? Somebody came and asked me the other day, a young guy, Swamiji, I am filled with sexual fantasies. Please give me some solution. I told him, just sit half an hour and meditate on those fantasies. He came back and said, no, Swamiji, I am not able to concentrate on it. Understand, your very nature of the mind, your very nature, constantly you are replaced. In mythology, we say, Shiva is a destroyer. He is not destroyer. He creates a new space. He creates a new space for many other things to happen. He is a rejuvenator, not destroyer. He creates a new space for many other things to happen. Understand, you are filled with Shiva energy, Shiva consciousness. In Sanskrit, the word Shiva means auspiciousness, causeless auspiciousness. Your inner space is filled with auspiciousness. That is why constantly the new inner space is created so that old thoughts can be replaced. The continuous flow of thoughts proves you are continuously unclutching. All you need to do is remember it. See, now you remember the pain shaft or joy shaft. Am I right? All your thoughts, you give meaning or you process. You live based on pain shaft or joy shaft. You see, your movements are happening either based on the idea of pain shaft or joy shaft. Let your movements happen by the remembrance of unclutching. That's all I am saying. Instead of acting based on the remembrance of joy shaft or pain shaft, act based on the remembrance of unclutching. That's all is the essence. See, when you, people ask me, no, if I am constantly remembering unclutching, how can I act? If you are constantly suffering with pain, you are acting. Are you not acting? See, even while you carry the remembrance of pain and suffering, you are acting. When you can act with the remembrance of pain, why not remembrance of unclutching? For a simple example, morning 8 o'clock, you sit in your car and start driving towards your office. 9 o'clock, you reach your office. Suddenly you remember, only after reaching the office, last 1 hour I was driving. How many of you experienced at least once this in your life? At least once. You would have experienced. See, then 1 hour you took so many decisions. Pressing the accelerator, changing the gear, stopping for red light. So many decisions. But you are not aware. When you can drive with unconsciousness, why not drive with a super consciousness? You can. Your day-to-day life is possible with the remembrance of unclutching. With the undercurrent of unclutching. That's what I call living enlightenment. One thing, this is the only thing you need. Simple courage to experiment in the beginning. Simple courage to experiment in the beginning. The undercurrent, you see, if you have a deep depression, do you stop going to the office? No. You may carry that, but your body moves. You are working. Maybe you may not be productive that much, or you may not be efficient that much. That is different. But your body is living. You are actually, instead of living depression, I am saying live enlightenment. But when we leave depression, we don't have all these questions. No, if I am depressed, how can my body move? We don't have questions. It became part of our life. Same way, in the initial level, you will have questions how to live enlightenment. But the constant remembrance of unclutching will not interfere in your mind or body movements. It will interfere only in one thing. It will do only one change in you. You will not carry your constant irritation. That's all. That constant irritation is the product of the fight between the ahankara and mamakara. The identity which you show to the outer world and to the inner world. That fight, if it stops, you are living enlightenment. See, when I express with a simple word, that irritation. But that irritation is the source of all pains and suffering. That irritation is the source of the whole maya, the whole illusion, whatever you call. So in the initial level, remembering that word unclutching, slowly, you don't even have to wait for years. Within few times when you try, you will suddenly see, if your enemy means if your mind is in the mental plane, means with the words, very powerful, then unclutching also will be like a word. If your mind is in the emotional level, just some subtle memories are flowing, then unclutching also can be just a simple remembrance. If your mind is just neither words nor visualization, just something is flowing which you don't understand, very rarely you will experience that space. At that moment, you don't even have to remember unclutching, just your very presence, you will see you are unclutched. If your enemy is mind, based on the strength of the enemy, the technique also will change itself. That's what I call the Mahavagya. Mahavagya means the ultimate truth. The ultimate initiation will be such, it will change its position, its strategy, its space, and its strength based on the enemy's strength. All you need to do is add the simple truth, unclutching, and when you work with this technique, you will see by your very nature you are unclutched. That is why you are able to have new thoughts. See, any depression can be replaced just by one thought. Let me have a cup of water. Let me have a cup of tea. Over. Trash your emails. You again go back to that trash and bring them back. That is where the problem starts. And you have a clear, very strong belief. No. Whatever is said and done, even if I have thrown it, it will come back. See, once you know how to throw that, even if it comes back, it's okay. Why are you afraid? Let us throw again. Give more power to the gap. Empower the gap instead of the thought. Empower the ability to unclutch. Cherish the ability to unclutch. Live the ability to unclutch. Then living the thoughts. There is only two kinds of life. Living thoughts, enlightenment. Simple choice.